So today we are going to talk about community detection in networks. So basically what community detection is essentially clustering a set of nodes in a graph. So this is what we are going to do today, and the clustering we are going to do will be based on the net structure of the network. So let's start by defining this problem of community detection, and then I'm going actually to talk to you about some social science research that explains why do we see these clusters in networks, why do they make sense, and they actually inform the development of the methods to be able to do this. So when we write or when we draw networks, let's say on a piece of paper, we often would like to think of them to have kind of the following structure. Right? We think of them as having these clusters, these communities, where the edges inside the cluster are more than the edges spanning across the clusters. And this is kind of how intuitively we like to think of networks, in particular social networks, perhaps where these types of clusters could correspond to social communities. We think of them in terms of, in biological networks, we can think of these as some kind of functional units, modules that are there to do a certain task and so on. So we'd like to think that the networks are not just kind of messy objects, but that they have this kind of clustering organization. So the question is, how did this picture arise? What kind of evidence do we have that these types of structure actually appears in networks, and what could be some reasons for it? So here is one way to think about this from the viewpoint of social networks. So right now what we'll do is we are going to do a bit of a dive in into classical social science and classical social network analysis. So the question is, how does information flow through networks? Think of a social network, right? Where basically we have people connected in a social network, and there are different links over which the information flows. And let's call these links short and long. And let's call them, you know, short as the ones that kind of are very kind of local. These are strong friendships. And let's also have these long links which we can think of as links to our acquaintances and kind of colleagues and people we, let's say, meet less often. And the way we can think of this is that, you know, we have these short strong links, and we have these weak long links to other parts of the network. So there was a seminal work back in 1960s by Mark Grenovetter, who's a sociologist here at Stanford University. And this is, I think, the most cited and the most impactful social science paper ever. And this is really about his research during his PhD, where he was asking about how do people find information through personal contacts. What he was looking at is how people find jobs. So he was asking people who were on the job market to basically, and have found a job, to tell him, where did you hear about this job? Which person did you tell you about this job opening? How did you apply? Things like that. And what was interesting is that contacts through which these people heard for job openings and found jobs were more often acquaintances than, let's say, close friends, right? So it wasn't that you would hear that people heard about new job openings from people they have very strong relationship with, that, you know, they spend a lot of time together, but they heard about new job openings through these acquaintances, people that they would kind of meet less, more rarely. And this is very surprising, because you would imagine that it is actually your friends, people you have strong relationships with, whose best interest is to help you, who are closest to you, who are the most motivated to help you find a job, to connect you with the job openings and so on. But what turned out was that it was actually casual acquaintances through whom these job seekers found about new jobs. So what this means is, if we go back to the picture that we had before, it was that basically it was these types of, let's say, acquaintance links, these weak links, to be the ones through which people heard about the jobs, and not necessarily these kind of strong interpersonal links. So this means that acquaintances were more helpful in this process. And the question was why. And Grenovetter gives this two perspective on a friendship or on a link in the network. So the first perspective on a link in the network is structural. It's about what is the structural role of a link in the network. So you can think about what is the structural role of a friendship in a social network, right? We can think about this particular edge being this kind of connecting different parts of the network, while this particular other edge being very well embedded inside the network, right? Having all these common friends and being a really strong relationship. So that's kind of structural. And then there is also the interpersonal view, which is about friendships being either kind of strong or weak, right? Having a very strong relationship with someone or having a much weaker relationship with each other. And what Grenovetter shows is that structural and interpersonal relationship of the link, they are connected. They are related to each other. So let me explain how. So first point is that Grenovetter makes the connection between the social and the structural role of an edge and shows that they are related, they are correlated, they are connected. So first is the structural point, right? The structural edge from the point of edge being in a network, he basically shows that structurally embedded edges, so edges that happen among in the densely linked parts of the network where there is a lot of common friends, that these edges tend to be strong edges, like interpersonally strong. And that these long-range edges that kind of connect different parts of the network, they tend to be socially weak, right? So what does this mean? This means that there is a relationship between the strength of the relationship and the structure of the relationship. So strength means strong links between people who have a lot of friends in common, and weak links connecting different parts of the network, right? So weak friendships are generally the ones that connect different parts of the network, and strong friendships are the ones where you have a lot of friends in common and so on. And what I wanna say is strong friendship is not defined by having a lot of friends in common. You can ask someone, who are your strongest friends? And then if you check in the social network, you will see these are the people you have a lot of friends in common. So these are the structurally strong, structurally well embedded relationships are socially strong, and structurally relationships that connect different parts of the network, they are socially weak. So those are two connections, two important aspects of a relationship. So social strength of a relationship and a structural role or position of the relationship. That's the first point. And then the second important point that Grenovetter makes is this notion of information flow. And he says that long-range edges allow you to gather information from very different, distant parts of the network. And this means that now you have access to all this distant information that can come to you and can be very useful to you, right? And he says that structurally embedded edges are heavily redundant in terms of information access, right? So if you think that, I don't know, this person A is an edge in the network and they are looking for jobs, yes, they have this three strong social relationships with these three other people. But essentially, these relationships are very redundant, right? Whatever one of these people knows, they can either tell them to know they directly, or perhaps, you know, they are going through casual conversations, tell it to this other node, who's going to tell it to know they. So in terms of information access, these edges are heavily redundant. While, for example, this weak long-range edge to some other part of the network, to this node B, this is a very useful edge because it gives you access to all this information from this other community. So this is the second point, is that strongly embedded edges are information redundant, and it is weak edges that give you access to very distant parts of the relationship, of the network. And this is important because if you look how social networks evolve, they evolve such that the communities form, in a sense that tightly connected clusters of nodes naturally form. And the reason for this is that the networks tend to evolve using triadic closure. What that means is that if you have two friends in common, you know, A has a friend B and A has a friend C, then sooner or later A and B are going to meet and they are going to create a link with each other. Another important aspect is that we like to connect with others that are similar to us, right? So if I am, I don't know, a computer scientist, or maybe I like soccer, football, right? Maybe I play football with node B. Probably I play football with node C as well. So they already will have something in common so they can form that relationship, right? So this is an important thing is that because we like to connect to others that are similar to us, so if I'm connected to two other people, they likely share some similarity, some aspect to myself. This means that they are also going to share that similarity, so they'll be more likely to bond and create an edge. So it means in networks, these are the edges that that like to form. So for example, A to B is a likely edge, and you know, to also A to C, because there is a common friend B in between. So these are examples of edges that happen to in social networks a lot. So now, you know, why are some reasons that these types of edges happen? Because if you remember early on, we were talking about clustering coefficient, right? The fraction of your neighbors that are connected with each other. And this is essentially a metric of this notion of a triadic closure. Because if we have this simple network structure here on the right, then you can say, you know, if B and C have a friend A in common, so why should B and C link to each other? First is they are more likely to meet each other because they have this common friend A, and maybe he invites them both for the coffee or something. Second thing is B and C are more likely to trust each other because, again, they have this common friend that they both trust. So they say, oh, you have this guy as a friend. I like him. You like him. Obviously, we have something in common. And then there is also another important point, which is A has incentive to bring B and C together, right? Because from A's point of view, it is hard or costly. It requires effort to maintain two relationships together. For node A. So if there is a triangle, so if A links to B, B links to C, then all of them basically can go and hang out together because they are all friends. So these are reasons for triadic closure. And there is an important aspect, is that actually social science research shows that being embedded, having a lot of these strong edges and a lot of triangles around you is easier, warmer. This is what humans seek for. And actually, for example, there is a famous study of teenage girls who have, for example, low clustering coefficient. They are found to more likely contemplate suicide. So basically, right, it is hard to not have friends who are friends with each other. So it's good to be well embedded in social clusters. That's kind of the social structures we humans seek. So now this Grenovetter explanation was a theory from the 60s, right? Basically what he said was the following. He said, edges that are embedded in the network, so edges that have high clustering coefficient, edges that have a lot of friends in common, edges that appear in dense parts of the network, these edges tend to be socially strong, and edges that connect distant parts of the network, they tend to be socially weak. And this is a prediction he made based on his research, but it was left untested for 40 plus years. And actually it was only in 2007 that this theory was actually kind of validated on real large scale data. And the study is based on cell phone data from one of the European countries, where you say the strength of a relationship, strength of an edge, will be the number of phone calls that we make in a given period, right? And the idea is that people you are strong friends with, you will make a lot of phone calls with, and people you are more acquaintances with, maybe you call them for Christmas and, you know, wish them a Happy New Year, for example. That would be, you know, once in a year type of phone call. So the prediction from Grenovetter would be that strong edges should be, these edges with lots of phone calls should be clustered together in small pockets, and then these edges that that span across different parts of the network, there the number of phone calls will be smaller. That's the prediction. The way this was operationalized was first to say the notion of how strong or weak is the edge structurally, and you quantify this by the metric called edge overlap. And simply you ask, what is the fraction of neighbors that edge endpoints have in common, right? So for example, here the edge overlap is zero because these nodes I and j have no friends in common, while here, for example, this is an overlap of one because they have all these neighbors, each of them, and they are both mutually connected to all of them. So here we would say this edge is very well embedded, it is structurally strong, and this edge is structurally weak, right? It kind of connects to different parts of the network that don't know each other. Right? And then what Grenovetter would say that when edges have low overlap, the number of phone calls will be very small. And when edges have high overlap, the number of phone calls will be very high. Here is now the result. This is the edge strength in terms of number of phone calls, and this is the neighborhood overlap. And this is the real data, and what you see is that the more the phone calls, the higher the overlap, which means that highly used links where a lot of phone calls happen, have high overlap, right? So links where there is a high number of phone calls look like this, and links where there is a lower number of phone calls have smaller overlaps. So they are structurally like that. And then here what also they show is an example of a null model where they would basically keep the network structure the same, but randomly reassign the edge strengths. And then you see that there is no relationship, just to, and this is expected and is just kind of a safety check to make sure that this analysis makes sense. So what this means is that, you know, the bigger the overlap, the stronger the edge personally. To give you a picture that is even more telling is that here is a part of this phone call network, and this is the strength of the edge. Red is very strong and yellow, green is weak in terms of number of phone calls. And what you see is that these red edges tend to happen in these kind of small clumps here. And you see that these long edges, they are mostly yellow, which means there is a small number of phone calls that happens over them. And just to show you the contrast, now I will show you the picture of the same network, but I'm going to randomly shuffle edge strands across the same structure. And what you will see is that now all of a sudden, this is how the network looks like, right? So if I randomly assign edge strands according to the real edge strands, you see how now these long range edges all of a sudden start to look red. And why is this? This is the reason because there is a lot of edges, strong red edges hidden in these clusters, and you just don't get to see them. And all these long range edges, they are all yellow. They all have very small number of phone calls in them. But if you now take these edge strands and randomly permute them, randomly assign them over the edges, then this is how the network would look like. Right? All of a sudden, we see that there is actually a lot of long range red edges that we just don't see in practice. So what does this mean? This means that edges that are strong interpersonally appear in densely knit clusters, and edges that are weak connect different parts of the network. And another experiment to validate this is to say, what if I take my network and I remove edges one by one by the increasing number of phone calls, right? First, I will remove edges with one phone call, then two phone calls, and so on. And then here is how I'm removing edges. And here is how does my network fall apart into different connected components, right? So as I'm removing edges, the network will start to get disconnected. And what you notice is that if I remove first the edges that have low number of phone calls, the network is going to fall apart into multiple disconnected components much faster if I would, for example, remove edges that are highly used. Because those edges are embedded in these clusters, so even if I remove them, I don't disconnect the network. But if I disconnect, if I remove these weak edges, then the network gets disconnected faster. The largest connected component is smaller, so the red line is below the black line. And then if I do something similar according, let's say now, to the edge overlap, where I say, let's remove edges with low overlap first, you see how now the largest connected component super quickly gets destroyed. Which basically the intuition is that if I remove these low overlap edges, very quickly I get these separate islands, separate disconnected components. So, you know, why did we spend these 20 minutes discussing about all this? Like, what did we learn? What we learned is that this conceptual picture of networks that I try to show, that I show here, is actually well grounded in sociological processes and social science. What we have also found out is that the interpersonal strength of a relationship and its overlap, its embedding in the network are related, right? So we showed that this type of nodes and these types of edges that have high overlap, that have a lot of friends in common, these tend to be interpersonally strong connections, and that edges with low overlap or zero overlap that kind of connects different parts of the network, they tend to be weak. They tend to be, you know, don't have high strength. So this is now very cool because this intuition can serve us to identify this type of bridge connections and be able to separate and be able to identify the clusters in the network.